Hi, welcome to the Shepherding Movement Me. This is a production of Elisha Bones Ministry. And I'm your host, Stephen Whitson. You're listening to the story of one man's journey through the world of the Christian cult, spiritual abuse, and church legalism that shapes a life for time on end. Now, for the sake of privacy, names have been changed. Our last names will not be used as much as possible. I might slip up here and there, of course. And I want to make the disclaimer that this ministry that we are talking about today, Jesus is Lord Ministry, has been redeemed by the founder's son. And I can best say it that way. Not too long ago, I had a chance to go back with my cousin and meet with him and sit down and talk with him and walk around on the property and talk about things. And it was just, I don't know how to describe it. It was just one of the best things to see what has happened and what has gone on there. I wish I had the video. I got a video of the years and different pictures and things like this, but not free to broadcast those pictures, but I wish you'd be able to see them. It would be kind of a real companion to what's here. So in last week's, we were talking about how the ministry got started, how we got into it, me and my family, the transitions going from Yucca Valley back to Omaha, and then back to going back into the ministry and landing in Sacramento, California, and being there for a couple of years, and then moving on to, I believe that Amarillo, Texas was the last place that we all met and everybody consolidated into. And that's kind of where I left off the story. But in today's blog, podcast, I should say, I'm going to be reading to you from David Moore's PhD paper, which is not the same thing, of course, as the book. You can find the book on Amazon, The Shepherding Movement, but this is the actual paper that he submitted from Regent University when he graduated there with his first PhD. So I'm going to be talking and starting on chapter 4. Now, what has gone on before in these chapters is it's brought up and talked about the history of the Fort Lauderdale Five. And the picture that I've got up on the podcast is with Don Basham, Derek Prince, Ern Baxter, Charles Simpson, and Bob Mumford, what they're called the Fort Lauderdale Five of that time, who were very much a part of the original charismatic movement back in the 1970s when it was first born. So here I am in chapter 4. What has gone on also before is the kind of the history of where and how it got to this point, how it all started during the 60s and different people and with New Wine Magazine and their involvement and all of that. So I'm going to without further ado, I guess, starting on chapter 4. And I'm just going to be reading through and make some comments and things like this and kind of relating it to where I'm at. Now, I got to make the note also that David Moore is now with Jack Hayford's church. The King's Institute in Dallas, Texas. He's a professor there. He's adjunct, I believe, at Life Pacific and several other places. Friend of a friend, I guess you could say, but yeah, from original roots, I guess, is from the Four Square Church, the same as I, and with Jack Hayford when he was out of Los Angeles, California, which, namely the Valley, I would should say, but, you know, his church was called Church on the Way, and so happens that also my brother was on staff there for many, many years, but here's where we begin this whole thing, and this is what it's going to be talking about, is how the Shepherding Movement was born, and we're working our way through. We've got about 39 minutes, and so we want to just kind of read through and make the comments. All right, here we go. And As 1971 began, the four teachers were doing much more than sorting out the problems with HSTM. Besides continuing their individual ministries and as often as possible teaching together, they were experimenting with videotape ministry, seeing it as a new opportunity for their teaching ministries. Because Tom Monroe's leadership was needed to manage HSTM, work toward the television station WFCB had slowed. Video Ministries, Inc., an associate minister from HTM, became a reality in early 1971 after an investment of nearly $100,000 had purchased cameras, lights, and fully equipped mobile van for videotaping. The van would follow the teachers around the nation to record their teachings. Now, videotapes would then be distributed at a rental fee from some 20 strategic locations across the United States. Now, teaching would not be restricted by the teacher schedules, and even small charismatic groups could be regularly impacted by their ministries, meaning we didn't have to wait till they come on TV or something else like that. We could get the TV or the tape and just listen. I remember a lot of times that we gathered for our meetings and church meetings, like Wednesday night church service, it would be centered on listening to these different tapes. The one that's most memorable, I believe it was Ern Baxter and the Keys of the Kingdom, and where he talked about Christ's descent was to get the keys and to set the captives free, and he goes on and talks about how spiritual authority, of course, of all believers. Now, at the same time I've been doing this, I have also been listening to Mars Hills, The Rise and Fall with Mark Driscoll. And how this all ties together is incredible, because in the podcast itself, they talk about Bob Mumford, Derek Prince, Don Basham, and the others. How there was that influence into that. In fact, later on, we're going to see that it's mentioned here, and it's tied into the tentacles are all over the place. When Mark Driscoll ended up getting out, he went to Robert Morris's conference and was talked about there about restoration and things. And that was back in 2014, right after Driscoll was resigned from Mars Hill and that whole debacle. So, the tapes and everything were very, very important and very much part of my upgrowing and upbringing and learning and things. So they scheduled a 6-week teaching engagement at three churches in the Washington, D.C. area in April and May of 1971, in which all teachings meetings were to be videotaped. Importantly, as a planning session with Simpson absent, the other three assigned to Simpson as teaching subjects for these meetings, discipleship, fellowship, and worship. Now, Simpson had never given a specific message on any of these topics, and the message he developed on discipleship for these meetings became one of the Shepherding Movement's seminal teachings. The meetings in Washington, D.C. include concepts on the need for spiritual maturity, obedience, life transformation, and submission to God and man. These were foundation to later teachings, especially that part about submission to God and to man. If you submit to God, then you have to have and be underneath authority. So this new teaching emphasized was direct response to the situation with HTSM that had brought them together. It was also a reflection of other concerns for the charismatic renewal. Concepts of discipleship, authority, and submission seem to address directly the individualism and lack of spiritual discipline. Among the segment of the renewal they were ministering to most often, these teachings on authority and submission were new to the four and to independent charismatics, since they all, according to Simpsons, were skeptical of authority because we associate authority with dead churches and abuse. Nevertheless, and now see that comment there, before we associate authority with dead churches and abuse. Mars Hill, I mean, that was central to what their problem was. The abuse that went on with people and, trying to protect and make people loyal to the ministry. I mean, God forbid that you weren't loyal or called the leaders into question. You just weren't allowed to be an individual. Nevertheless, they believed the individualism and lack of maturity and renewal necessitated the teachings despite their seminal and untested forms. but they didn't practice individualism. That's what I got to tell you. Throughout 1971, the four men, while still teaching on other things, became more focused on these new truths they saw as essential. And many of these teachings were videotaped and distributed through video ministries. Now, perhaps in part because Purvis had written many important charismatic leaders suggesting the four had taken over the HTS men, and that's a conflict that was started a little bit previous and explains in the thing in the paper earlier or in the book. And it's put under strict doctrinal control. Questions over the association of the Big Four of Florida boys continued. While some of the focus was on Mumford and Simpson joining with the demon chasers, Basham and Prince, the concerns went beyond the issues. Charles Simpson's friend and spiritual confidant, Ken Summerall, had questioned Simpson's decision to make such a substantial life-changing commitment to the other three men without any consultation. Additionally, a variety of stories began to circulate about their association. Some suspected they might be under an ulterior or clandestine motive. Others questioned how long four independent leaders with popular ministry could hold together. And trust me, they did for quite a long time after that. All of this made them realize that the larger charismatic communities found it easier to receive their ministries individually than collectively. And this was troubling to them since they, without Christian, considered themselves to be teachers to the broader renewal, with their new association providing personal accountability and protection as they carried out their ministries. So as a consequence to the suspicions regarding their association and other issues that challenged the charismatic renewal's unity, Basham, Mumford, Prince, and Simpson were instrumental, along with Dennis Bennett and Harold Brunson and David Duplessis. Now, Dennis and Rita Bennett, they have a book out. He was an Episcopalian pastor who, in his prayer life, got baptized with the Holy Spirit and started speaking in tongues. The minute the church found out and his denomination found out, they had him kicked out. Because, of course, we all know that spiritual gifts died out years ago. That was a pun, people. So in starting an annual Charismatic Leaders Conference, the first conference was held in June in 1971 in Seattle, Washington, with 25 leaders of the renewal in attendance. These leaders' meetings became an annual event, eventually become known as the Glencoe Meetings. Each spring, charismatic leaders would convene for several days of dialogue and interaction. The group met in Tulsa in 1972, St. Louis in 73 and 74. In 1971, Seattle leaders' meeting was an important step in establishing the charismatic unity because it served as an example of the ecumenical commitment that Basham, Mumford, Prince, and Simpson were attempting to show. Basham wrote of that first meeting, "I remember clearly the garter suspicious way we looked at each other the first morning. Most of that day were spent in slowly lowering our defenses and summoning enough courage to speak openly and honestly with one another. The next 3 days passed in earnest and sometimes heated discussions about water baptism and demonology. The subject of demons and deliverance was so controversial that times tempers flared sharply. Ministers who were for years held strong convictions that a Christian could not have a demon or need deliverance felt those of us involved in the deliverance ministry were not only in error, but were creating real division in the body of Christ. After one of these sessions, an elderly Pentecostal minister sought me out privately." So that elderly Pentecost was David Duplessis, who told Basham that he was deeply concerned that his emphasis on deliverance might ruin his ministry because it was proving to be divisive. Now, I've read, I believe it was Don Basham's book, Deliverance from Evil. I think it was early in the ministry. I was living up in Sacramento. And if I remember correctly, 13, somewhere right in there. I read the book, scared the bejeebers out of me because of the stories he told about these demon possessions and these crazy wild things that he went through. And it got so much so that I was living down in the basement, and you had to go up the stairs, of course, and then into the main room when you wanted to go to the rest of the house. And so one afternoon that light went out, that light bulb. And as I started to go up the stairs, man, my hair would go up on end. I thought, oh, no. Man, and I'm reading the book, and I mean, I'm just getting the EBGs and willies of all of that. But by the time I got to the book, one of the comments that he said is that you have nothing to fear, that if you turn around and face that, that it will go away. So I did that one time. I was going up the stairs, man, a hair on my neck going, wow, you know, creeping out. I stopped and I turned and I said, in the name of Jesus. And that feeling went away, boom, right there and then, gone. And from that point on, it never did. It never came back. I could go up that stairs 100 times in the pitch black and it never bothered me. But it is something that stuck with me the rest of my life in ministry. And that, of course, is a story for a different time. Now, Bashir then reminded Duplessis how much controversy surrounded Duplessis' own ministry in taking the Pentecostal message to non-Pentecostals. The discussion on the several days of meetings helped Duplessis and other leaders to tolerate Bashir and Prince's demonology and build mutual respect. Recognizing a need for guidelines to help future disputes within the rule, a code of ethics was drawn up at the 1971 Seattle meeting. The document, entitled Ethics for Christian Leaders, was drafted and solely agreed upon, although there was no formal signing of the document. The document called for criticism and complaints against any fellow leader or his ministry to be handled according to Matthew 18 guidelines. You know, do not receive an accusation against an elder except by two or three witnesses, and so forth. So, by first going privately to the persons to establish the true facts, then if the problem was not resolved, at least two other ministers should be involved. And finally, if nothing was resolved, the matter should be brought to a larger group of fellow ministries. Now, all these steps were taken before issues were to be made public. And it would prove significant that two key players in the dramatic 1975 controversy over shepherding, Pat Robertson and Dima Shakarian, were not present in 1970, nor were they to be regular participants in the annual Charismatic Leaders Conferences. That's something you got to remember. Of course, Pat Robertson is the head of, you know, ran for president, the head of that TV program. And Dima Shakarian was the founder and leader of the International Prayer Breakfast, or Men's Prayer Breakfast. He was the head of that one. Now, despite their resignation from New Wines Magazine editorial board, the four men continued to be viewed as the leaders of the HSTM, and many believed New Wine was their magazine. For a time, this proved personally frustrating to them, since they each maintained independent ministries completely separate from HSTM. They were not receiving their salaries from Fort Lauderdale organization, never did. Except for Basham later, who served the magazine editorially. Now, it is understandable, however, that this perception grew even stronger. Circumstances by the end of 1971 were setting the course for their even closer linkage to New Wine Magazine and the Fort Lauderdale floor. I grew up in New Wine Magazine. I mean, that's all we ever had around the house, and we listened to it and read it and all the way. But I'm sure that most people don't know, and I believe, from what I've understood, and I could be wrong, that New Wine is what we now call Christianity Today. You can go online and look up old sermons and articles from these five men and find them all over the internet. So in the summer of 71, Bob Mumford invited several young men, most of who were in successful youth ministries in the Jesus Movement, to move to Fort Lauderdale to be discipled by him as a kind of discipleship experiment. So by fall of 1970, these men had moved to Fort Lauderdale and soon were meeting early each morning with Mumford for prayer, worship, and training. The discipleship plan was well-intentioned but did not work out because the principles were not developed sufficiently to provide a clear purpose and a direction for the group. In other words, where was it going to end up? How long were they going to be there? And then when would they be released to ministry, and so on and so forth. So after 6 months, the group dissolved, with several men moving from Fort Lauderdale to pursue other ministry opportunities. From this original discipleship group, however, came three men: Robert Grant, Dick Key, and Paul Petrie. Paul Petrie, who would later work closely with Mumford. In addition, lasting relationships among the men were established that continued for years. Now, Paul Petrie, that name there, that is the name that will come up in the Mars Hills. He became part of Mars Hills. I'm pretty sure we're talking about the same man. I'm almost positive that. I don't have absolutely confirmation at this point, but I believe it is the same man. who had, was part of Mars Hill and later spoke against some of the things that happened out there. He would later work closely with Mumford. In addition, lasting relationship among the men were established and continued for years. So another part of the Fort Lauderdale story is the charismatic ecumenism that had developed around the HSTM and its ministries. The leaders of the charismatic prayer groups in the area joined with the four teachers and other pastors in a vision to work together as one church in the city. Charismatic Hap Arnold, who pastored Memorial Church, a former Southern Baptist congregation, hosted a Sunday evening believers' meeting beginning in 1969. This international meeting encouraged the exercise of the gifts of the prophecy, glossolalia, and its interpretation, and the practice of prayer for physical healing. Basham, Mumford, Prince, and Simpson often were the Bible teachers at these meetings whenever they were in town. In August of 71, Bob Mumford started teaching a Thursday night Bible class at Memorial Church in Fort Lauderdale. This class grew steadily, and by early 1973, had outgrown the church. So the class moved to the Governor's Club Hotel, meeting on Monday nights, often with hundreds in attendance. Now, this Bible study became a source for many of the taped presentations of the movement's distinctive teachings. Charles Simpson, after pastoring Bayview Heights Baptist Church in Mobile for 14 years, decided to resign and move to Fort Lauderdale area in December of 1971 to work closely with those other three men and to work with video ministries. Simpson invited Sam Phillips, a charismatic Southern Baptist from Lubbock, Texas, to pastor the church in Mobile. Phillips was a longtime friend, and the church initially received him well. At the time of his resignation, Simpson was convinced Bayview Heights was ready for his departure, since he had trained these men serving as the elders and leaders of the church. So when the Mobile church had become fully charismatic after Simpson's experience of spirit baptism, the entire deacon board resigned. Seeing the need to restructure the church, Simpson restudied biblical eschatology, ecclesiology, and sometime later he also ran across a small pamphlet, The Lost Secret of the Early Church, that emphasized the need for small house church groups to train and equip Christians to be voted and committed to followers of Christ. Now let me stop here for a moment. That was the whole point of the Jesus as Lord ministries. We were to be a house church, as I've talked about, living in Yucca Valley, then Sacramento, Phoenix, Amarillo, and then now, there was one other one in there, I can't remember. All of a sudden it just goes blank. But that was the whole idea, was to have these house groups where leaders would come in, they would be trained and equipped, and then sent out to the churches. And so you lived in a house, and it basically became a commune. Best way to describe a commune with a bunch of people living together. So soon after, Simpson began training lay leaders, though never calling it discipleship. The training of leaders was driven by a need. After losing so many leaders, several men who participated in the lay leadership training eventually became elders, and some went into pastoral ministry. Now, The Lost Secret of the Early Church also reinforced Simpson's growing realization that the church was simply and constitutionally the people of God in community. And that's what we called ourselves, the Jesus is Lord ministry. We were a community, and we called ourselves community. All the way through Sacramento, we were community. We call ourselves afterwards, you know, when we lived in community. So Simpson believed the most vital question facing Western civilization is, what is the church? Along with Basham, Mumford, and Prince, Simpson became more convinced that house churches were central to New Testament ecclesiology and were the missing dimension in contemporary church practices. After Simpson arrived in Fort Lauderdale, he formed a home meeting with a number of men and their families, and feeling the need for a circle of close friends like him, like Mumford earlier attempted, his home meetings became an experiment in discipleship and house church ministry. The five or six couples with a few singles would gather for dinner once a week to share their lives openly and honest with Simpson, the leader. Though Simpson led the small group, he still attended a local Southern Baptist church with his family. What are those things that developed out there? When we were in community, we would have family meetings. And it was a place and a time, of course, to discuss your issues. And if somebody offended you, which often turned into a lot of fights and a lot of hurt feelings, because it wasn't always done diplomatically or in love, but I would say more out of retaliation and anger. And me as a kid, I don't know what's going on. I'm just watching grown-ups go on back and forth like this. So, yeah, even the kids were a part of that, and we heard things. In later stories, I heard it developed into where you had to go through a healing of past things, so they would confess their sins of the past in order to get healed from. So parents were confessing their sins that just mortified these kids, finding out past affairs and you know, dad used to be a thief or whatever it might have been. And it actually destroyed a lot of families. So a young musician and member of the small group, Garrett Gustafson, moved to the area to be trained by Simpson. A California, and then Bruce Longstretch, with whom Simpson met at a conference in California, moved to Florida as well. These men became Simpson's first formalized disciples, and both eventually would lead churches in the movement. Through 1971 into early 72, the four teachers took on a increasing role in leading the HCSTM, and then in late 1971, they began serving the board of directors for the nonprofit corporation, and they become more directive in advising the ministry staff. So by late, changing my chair. By early 1972, the teachers had again taken a more visible participation in New Wine magazine through teaching articles and participation in questions and answer forums. So in 1972, the itineraries of the four were being regularly printed in the magazine. Despite their growing involvement at the HSTM, the teachers continued to maintain their own teaching ministries. Then in March 1972, an issue of New Wine announced the change in the name of the STM to the Christian Growth Ministry, CGM. The new board, which now included four men, decided early in 72 that CGM better reflected the ministry's purpose in bringing spiritual growth to believers through the Bible teachings, and also served to distance them from any negative association that was formerly with HSTM. So the editorial that announced the name change stated that CGM's focus and vision. Quote, as most of our readers know, the charismatic outpouring increases daily, so the teaching need expands. The magnitude of the demand for teaching, however, has made it necessary to use the electronic means of teaching, i.e. audio cassettes or reel tapes, videotape, as well as literature. This magazine biannual Christian Growth Conference Guide has sovereignly brought these men, ministries, and equipment together here in Fort Lauderdale to establish a spiritual kitchen from which he can provide for the needs of his people. So this is what he's 72, and this is about the time my dad and my uncle started putting things together in Omaha and then into Southern California. And I'm assuming I don't have it. Now, my dad and the leader, Stan, have both passed away. I know some of the other men that have come out of it, but it'll be an interesting conversation to get with them and talk about those early years from their perspective. Now, at about this time, Bob Muffer invited Dick Key, still living in Fort Lauderdale, to serve as the CGM administrator. So New Zealander Bill Hythorn-Thwaite had succeeded Neil Frank as New Wine magazine editor with the January 72 issue, but would be replaced just 5 months later by Key. Under Key's leadership, CGM and the magazine leased new offices and production space, and by December of 1972, issue had a monthly circulation of more than 60,000. And over the next 2 years, New Wine would continue to feature most of the prominent leaders of the Charismatic Renewal, along with Basham, Mumford, Prince, and Simpson. Through 72, an emphasis on spiritual authority and submission was increased among the teachers. So and spiritual submission and authority. The whole structure was built on this, that you had somebody who was the head of the community, you had junior elders in there, and everybody is in spiritual authority to one another. And I bring this out because in my next podcast, I will give you the details of the ending of it and how we eventually got out, but it'll be in much greater detail than what I've gone through before and talking about it. But getting back to it, the spring of 72, the conference in Miami focused on developing a theme of spiritual authority. So, quote, setting the tone for this spring's Christian Growth Conference was a series of messages by the most noted conference speaker and teacher, Bob Mumford. And as Bob taught on authority and submission, God began to unfold before the eyes of the believers gathered in Miami, Florida, a new glimpse of what he is going to do throughout his body in the last days. In past years, God has laid the emphasis of teaching on the baptism of the Holy Spirit, water baptism, and the gifts of the Spirit and other topics usually associated with the charismatic movement. This year, the message came through loud and clear of a new era, authority. God is beginning to place in his church the authority that has been truly lacking for so many years. Along with this came a new understanding of the home and the family relationship and divine order in the church and a believer's personal relationship and submission to God. So this September issue of New Wine presented the first in a significant series of seven articles by Mummer called Lawlessness. And these articles focus on the need for practical obedience to God and submission to his delegated authority in all spheres of his life. On the back page of the May 72 New Wine, Buffett recommended Watchman Nee's book, Spiritual Authority, with the comment, "Spiritual authority is what the Master is saying to his body of Christ across this nation." Now, what I remember, that book being so prominent, when Stan was with my dad and they were here in Omaha, and right before, I guess it was before we took off into that ministry, I remember that's when it had to happen. Trust me, people, it's not easy to remember back that far. But I remember my dad riding with them, my dad and my uncle. And my uncle, dad is driving, my uncle is sitting there reading a book to him. And that book was Spiritual Authority. And I look over at my library right now, and there that book sits. Spiritual Authority. That was back in the 1970s. That book that I have on my counter and these other books are over 50 years old, but were a key piece of teachings and shaping of ideas about what spiritual authority was within the church. Another significant article in New Wine was Charles Simpson's article, Covering of the Lord. And in the October 72 issue, this article was a direct result of the HSTM leadership crisis in 1970 and focused on the covering, or protection provided by submitting oneself to God's delegated authority in the home, church, and civil government. So by 73, an ecclesiastical emphasis by Mumford and the others reflected in both their articles in New Wine and their teachings focused at conferences. In 72, 73, all four men taught frequently on the fivefold ministry gifts of the Ephesians. Remember those? I remember those sermons so well. That, you know, on those topics and talking about what an apostle was, a prophet, evangelist, and shepherds and teachings, what they were supposed to be and what they were to do and how they worked within the family. That was all foundational to it. So in January 73, Prince started a series of New Wine drawn from what he was teaching in conference on the subject of the body of Christ. Specifically, he emphasized the roles of apostles and prophets as present-day ministries. Now, this is 1974, people. This is where the prophetic reformation began that we see today, the apostolic movement that came out of the third wave, and those men that are all part of that. Several men, names-wise, all of a sudden, I'm going blank on them, but the Toronto Blessing and those that were associated, like Cheon and Dutch Sheets, those men were all part of this third wave and wrapped up in these new apostolic ministry. The guy who wrote all the books on spiritual warfare, I can see his name, gray, black glasses, Peter Wagner. It took me a minute there, yes, but Peter Wagner. This is where this was all born out of. Now, Prince also presented an idealistic view of a one-city, one-church concept in which Christians congregate not by denomination but by geographic groupings of cells or house churches in which leaders emerge. Those leaders then join together to form the church government of the city. And Prince believed that the church needs a divine revolution, and it's on its way. And so, Jesus is Lord was born in Yucca Valley in a dude ranch, where families were invited to come, and they left their churches or where they were part of, and became part of the ministry. Uh, Now, that divine revelation came in the development of the concept of pastoral ministry that they termed the shepherd-sheep relationship. At Mumford's Monday night meetings at the Governor's Club, he taught a series of messages entitled Sheep and Shepherds. Oh, I remember that sermon. Wow, I remember that one. I see some of these names. I haven't read this paper in a while, but to read that, yeah, there I remember that one. I remember hearing it. Can't tell you much was on it, but I can tell you I remember hearing it. And he told everyone present, you need to find a shepherd. You make a commitment to him. He makes a commitment to you. If you don't have someone to whom you can go and say, brother, I want you to shepherd me, you better find one in God and find him soon. And that was the whole heart of what we did and those men and my father became part of. For Mumford and Simpson, the key to making pastoral care was for a definite one-to-one personal relationship to be formed with each person and shepherd-led. Now, the four teachers now began teaching widely on the need for personal relationship to a shepherd. They saw shepherds as the most important of God's delegated authorities and mediating his government on the earth. Jesus, as the great shepherd, delegated under-shepherds to the care of his sheep. Now, I've got about 8 minutes left, and I want to diverge for just a second. See, this whole concept of making this commitment, and I'll talk about it in my own personal experience as we got out. But the idea was, under-shepherds, the spiritual abuse that would go on was this way. You had the one person who was in charge of the house, but then, these couple of elders. And if anybody didn't toe the line, wasn't doing right, wasn't, you know, made this mistake or anything, they'd be called before them. And it was very often that if junior elders were told, we're going to strip you of your authority, that's what we're going to make you this person, or an elder that they didn't find handling himself very well with his family or whatever it might be, you're going to be demoted if you keep this up. So the positions and the power and authority were always at the whim of the leader, whoever was in charge of the house. And I don't know that people vied for position to be the leader, but I remember over that year, we grew and swelled and sometimes shrunk. And I think over that year, we probably went through at least three or four different elders, lead teachers or pastors of the house, until eventually they put my dad in charge, and by that time there's no more than 10 or 15 people there, which, was kind of a joke. But I guess they eventually didn't made him an under-shepherd or under-elder or something like that, a junior elder was his kind of title for a while. Well, this concept of shepherding, back to the paper, was a logical next step in implementing the ecclesiology-oriented principles of authority and submission, covering and fivefold ministry offices. Moreover, they're already developing concepts of discipleship and how church dovetail well with the shepherding emphasis. Disciples emphasized the need for mentoring by a more mature leader, and house groups provided the venue for building the accountability and community of the four teachers I believed is so essential. This led to the fusion in which a shepherd would care for a small group of people in a house church or a cell group. And we were doing the house church. Now, this concept became the most basic ecclesiastical structure in the shepherding movement. Now, Bob Mumford was convinced that God was directing the innovations in church structuring. In 1973, he said, I believe right now that the Lord himself, by the Holy Spirit, is presently dividing the body into cells. The move of God in cell groups is about 10 years old. At that time, Mumford saw the cells groups as 8 to 12 people meeting together under a shepherd elder, and he effectively stated in the Fort Lauderdale Bible class, these cells are the key to what God is doing on the earth. Now, Mumford and the teachers thought that finding a shepherd was a crucial step in finding one's placement in Christ's body, and believers not to be casual about church participants who simply attended meetings. Each believer was a vital and important participation in the church, and relationship was the key word. To be involved in church meant to have a vital relationship, first with the shepherd and then with the other believers. And the goal was for the development of committed relationships in which believers found identity and function in the body. Now, the focus of commit relationships had community fostered new teachings emphasis, the concept of covenant relationship. In 1972, Simpson taught that the anatomy of a covenant in Fort Lauderdale. Therefore, Simpson and the three leaders began to openly discuss the term covenant relationship. And so, basically, my father and the men and all of those entered into covenant relationship, which I'll explain in the next podcast why that, how that plays out, because the basic idea is that if me and you are in a covenant relationship, then I have to trust you no matter what. If somebody's not in covenant relationship, well, then they're suspect. I have to believe this person that I am in covenant relationship. They're right. I'm with them. And that's the most important relationship that we have or I have within this group of people. So they came to believe that Christianity in the biblical sense is covenant relationship to God through Jesus Christ and then as to others. And so as a consequence of that initial covenant relationship with God, all believers were brought into relationship with one another. They believed covenant relations were one for more for an answer for the problem of independence among charismatics. And it was not a biblical option to walk alone. But believers were to be vitally connected to shepherds and fellow Christians and to learn to demonstrate commitment, loyalty, accountability, and service within the community life. Now, just a real quick thing back when you go back to Mars Hills and Mark Driscoll's issues was he demanded loyalty, he demanded obedience, and then if you did not follow along, you got fired, demoted, kicked out, people talked about you, and then you would be shunned from that ministry. These things were all planted here in the shepherding movement. Now, generally, these teachings were well received in conferences and camps at which these four men spoke. And their teachings seemed to be another dimension of the revitalization of New Testament truth charismatics experienced over a decade. And the early 1970s were exciting and exhausting times for Basham, Mumford, Prince, and Simpson, who were in as much demand as ever. The teachers also remained committed to the practice of their concepts of shepherding, covenant relationship, and house churches with the people they were directly associated with. In Fort Lauderdale, by spring of 73, several house church cell groups were being led by shepherds. Bob Mumford, Basham, and Prince were each leading groups, as well as Simpson, who was preparing to move back to Mobile. So those groups would have been one of my groups that he's talking about. Several house churches in 73, that would have been us down in Yucca Valley. And then Prince were each leading groups with some who was preparing to move back to Mobile, Alabama. These small groups were not formally structured or organized churches, but were relationally focused around meals, prayer, worship, Bible teaching, and recreation. We seem to have forgot the recreation part of that, but I remember a lot of meals and prayer and worship. That was the heart of these things. So an important influence on the developing concept of discipleship was the ministry of Argentinian pastor Juan Carlos Ortiz. Basham, Mumford, and Prince heard Ortiz speak in the fall of 73 and invited him to Fort Lauderdale in October. His teaching centered on the principles of small group discipleships and Orville Swindle. And he tracked Ortiz's meetings. Mumford acknowledged how the Ortiz was a strong influence on his own thinking regarding discipleship and shepherding. Watchman Nee's book, Spiritual Authority, was also a continuing conceptual influence on Mumford. We've come down to the end of our time here. I think I brought out a few of the points. Those who are interested can go online and find the book. You can buy it. And if you have access to some resource, you might be able to find it otherwise. But it is the Shepherding Movement is what it's called by David Moore. And if you want to find it, I'm sure you'll be able to get to it and be able to read this for yourself. All right. Thanks for listening, guys. And I got to pick out a song here. I don't know which one. Here's one of my favorite songs from back then when I was just back in about 72, I guess.
Did you know I'd go to sleep?